Thundermont was given good advice. He warned his congregation to refrain from sin and vice. He drew a fiery picture about the devil down below and said, folks, quit your sinning, or to him you're bound to go. Why, hell is full of vampire women. Well, whiskey, gin, and dice. Satan, tell him to get behind thee and prepare thou for paradise. Mose Jackson jumped up from his chair and said, Parson, is that true? That hell is full of what you said? Well, then just let me say to you, if what you say is positive truth, oh, death, where is thy sting? I don't care now about no pearly gate, or to hear the angels sing. With booze and women down below, Mr. Devil and I will just put on a show. Because if what you say is the positive truth, oh, death, where is thy sting?
Sun went down and the jungle fire was burning. Down the track came a hobo hiking, and he said, boys, I'm not turning. I'm headed for a land that's far away, beside the crystal fountains. So come with me, we'll go and see the big rock candy mountains. In the big rock candy mountains, there's a land that's fair and bright, where the handouts grow on bushes and you sleep out every night. Where the boxcars all are empty and the sun shines every day. On the birds and the bees and the cigarette trees, the lemonade springs where the bluebird sings. In the big rock candy mountains, in the big rock candy mountains, all the cops have wooden legs, and the bulldogs all have rubber teeth, and the hens lay soft-boiled eggs. The farmer's trees are full of fruit, and the barns are full of hay. Oh, I'm bound to go where there ain't no snow, where the rain don't fall, the wind don't blow, in the big rock candy mountains.
There was an eclipse that took place 7 years ago, went right across America. There's another eclipse coming right across America. It'll make a perfect cross on the center of the nation.
God made the first sign go through seven cities named Salem on August 21st, 2017.
The word Salem, according to Bible, is peace. So God is saying seven times he offered peace. The next eclipse is coming. It goes through several cities here, particularly Nineveh, 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 Nineveh. So first we have seven cities called Salem, and now seven cities called Nineveh. Seven and seven. Seven cities called Salem, seven cities called Nineveh, and 7 years apart. Right in the center of the cross is a city called Rapture. What is God's message? He's coming very, very soon.
All I ask is, if we have to give these bastards our lives, we give them hell before we do!
The tragedy of our day is the climate of fear in which we live.
Talking about the Salomon Brothers building collapsing.
I would ask the congressman to withdraw that comment and tell us that he really mean that.
I don't know what I said.
I did not have sexual relations with that woman.
That certain people be put to death.
Thieves were possessed as weapons of mass destruction. 9/11 attacks were carried out by Al Qaeda.
You can't handle the truth.
I remember that which meant the most. We are still here.
We have to say yes to the
truth. May I have to remember anymore?
hot chemical to the water that turned the friggin' rock gay.
Red Mark, no. It's a big club, and you ain't in it.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the much smaller club that you are in, which is The System Is Down, the least comfortable show on the web. I don't think I'm allowed to say that anymore, because I'm not even uncomfortable anymore in today's day and age. But we are gonna get a little bit uncomfortable today as we talk about, I want to apologize for any rambling that I do, any long intros or anything, because the time that we have left together on this God's green earth is short. We're running out of time. That is all. But in the meantime, I want to thank you for supporting the show. People like Abrogate Authoritarians, Michael, Marks, Scott, something, Kimberly, Owen, Brian, RJ, JC, Justin, Joey, Bonnie, Adam, Donald, Leah, Danielle, Zareth Anarchy, Heflum Swoozles, SDG, Vanzot Media, Rick Duran, Javari, Paul Brandenberger, Ryan Mortensen, John Odermatt, Howie Snowden, Trenton Campbell, Justin Zelensky, William Wells, and many, many more. If you want to get your name on that list and have it read incorrectly someday, go on over to patreon.com/thesystemisdown. We'll get more weird, more raw, more offensive, more semi-weekly content whenever we have time, but God knows if we will have any more time. So we're not doing one today. It's fine. We're doing this bonus Saturday broadcast because, well, typically on this show we talk about the news and it's kind of a smattering of all the different things that are going on in the world and they don't always like relate to each other. It's just news and we make fun of it. But today's episode is no exception to that rule because none of these stories have anything to do with each other. And if you think that they do have something to do with each other, you are a conspiracy theorist, which, as we all know, means that you are a white supremacist. So I have a guest today and I would like to bring him on now. He's been hanging out here in Dave's spot for the last couple of minutes, just admiring the shenanigans. But we have, let me see, we've got Mr. Raven from Nephilim Death Squad. How are you doing, man?
Close enough. You can call it Nephilim Death Squad. Dude, I'm happy to be here. Can I say that your intro is a banger, and it's nice to be hanging out with other white supremacists, a.k.a. conspiracy theorists. I am David Lee Corbo, a.k.a. The Raven, one half of Nephilim Death Squad, the conspiracy and supernatural podcast where we kind of see world events as they unfold through the biblical lens. And I'm happy to be here during this particular episode because obviously it's chock full of biblical lens. So sure. Thank you so much for having me, Dan.
Absolutely. And back in the day, I dug a lot more into the conspiracy stuff on the show, got a lot into the Genesis 6 stuff, the Nephilim stuff, the Flat Earth stuff, all the classics. And it's been a while. So happy to see other people coming out of the woodwork, being willing to have the brand of crazy person put on them in order to, you know, explore things. Where do you land on all that? Like, to you, is it more exploring, like, I don't know, like thought experiments, or do you take this stuff seriously?
Well, admittedly, I've been a conspiracy I'm 33 years old now. I've been a conspiracy theorist for probably 06 is when I first really started to look into the idea. I remember what the first things that caught my attention were. It was things like the impending martial law that was going to come one day, or the fact that they could convert Walmarts into FEMA camps with ease during these martial law lockdowns, or, you know, just a lot of, I, for example, and this isn't my own thinking, but I saw the pandemic coming, but I just thought it was going to happen a lot sooner. I don't know if anybody remembers, but even before this is when you started to hear whispers of it on the internet, but Jesse Ventura famously, I think in maybe 08 or 09, had an episode of his show, Conspiracy Theorist, where he had a woman on talking about how one day, and I'll try to use covert language, I know you're on YouTube, I don't want to get sure. you pulled, but it was like, they're going to manufacture, you know, an illness one day. And that isn't going to be necessarily the bad thing. What's going to be even more terrible than that is the cure for it that they're going to manufacture, and that is something that's going to be very dangerous. And I thought for the longest time that it was going to be of the avian nature or of the swine nature, and now of course we're hearing whispers of that, but this is something that terrified me as a 16-year-old. I was waiting right. for these things, and I was a little bit too ahead of the curve. I scared my friends, I scared my family members, And then lo and behold, nothing came to pass, and I just looked like an asshole. But so when you ask whether or not I take these things seriously or not, they're an ingrained part of my personality at this point. My developmental years as I turned into a young adult were immersed in this. This is what I was marinated in as I came to adulthood.
What got you into it? Was it 9/11? It's usually
9/11. No, actually, what got me into it was, I'll keep the story kind of short because we can go off on a tangent here, and I would love to get into this red heifer, eclipse situation that's going on. But essentially, my grandmother, it turns out, was an abductee victim, an alien abductee victim since childhood. And she passed away when I was very young, but I was put onto some of her stories by other family members. Didn't have the context, just thought it was scary stories that they were sharing with me about waking up in the middle of the night, unable to move, seeing the appearance of shadow people, et cetera, et cetera, bright white lights, and feeling the sensation of being taken elsewhere. Fast forward, she dies when I'm six. When I'm 16, I start to put these pieces 16, together.
We're already getting some numerology here. So,
over
which
and
level
over,
of yeah, Mason?
Well, hey. Right now I'm 33 years old. And if you are into numerology at all, I'm a 33 life path, which has yet to benefit me. So
and today's
maybe
April
not
6th,
all it's chalked
so,
up to be.
You know?
Go
on.
So really, it was kind of this supernatural aspect, this shadow people sleep paralysis thing that first got me into it. My mother put me onto a book that her mother, my grandmother, said never to read. And the reason she said never to read it is because she felt that this book accurately described what she was experiencing, and it like horrified her. Turns out that book was a book called Communion by an author named Whitley Strieber. And it was an amalgamation of abduction victim testimonies. So my grandmother put together before she passed away that this is what was happening to her. And that just sent me off because I recognize those patterns in my life. I recognize those patterns in people that were close to me. My father had these experiences. And when you go into the supernatural world, it's rife with all this, you know, elements of Satanism and things like that. And that plugs, honestly, this was the real first connection that I made. It plugs perfectly into all of the stuff that we see in Hollywood and in the music industry. And once I saw that, all the symbolism in every music video, in every Hollywood film, people would tell me that it was purely coincidental or it was done for shock value in order to garner an audience. That didn't make sense to me, right? Because you go, well, if I'm an artist and I'm trying to hit a target demographic, why would I aim for the smallest, nichest, craziest, probably brokest demographic being conspiracy theorists? You know, why am I pandering to these people? It just didn't make any sense. And so that was my first connection.
Yeah. I dig it. So how did you, I wasn't familiar with you before Nephilim Death Squad. I was familiar with Top Lobster and all that. And I love, again, the Genesis 6 stuff. So I love what you guys are doing. But how did you come, are you old friends with Top, or how did you get involved in the podcast space? And we will get into the news here.
So,
and I want to have you on soon to get more into your background if we make it that far alive.
Sure. Yeah. Who knows how long we have, right? But I guess I have been sort of called to produce content for a long time. The only problem is I sucked at the marketing aspect of it and was playing to a crowd of no one for the longest time. I was doing comedy content. I was doing sort of thoughtful interviews with people that I found interesting, but were of no particular pattern.
Yeah.
Just people that I thought were interesting. And that could have been anything from graphic designers to hunters, all kinds. I kind of think I was doing a dollar store Joe Rogan thing for a long time.
Same.
Yeah. And yeah, and you just kind of are trying to find your way. Coincidentally, or not coincidentally, by design, my podcast was called Where I Belong. And it was me just trying to find it. So I've been a podcaster now for, I think I just got the notification on Facebook, because you know how they'll show you your memories. Yeah. And my first episode was this month, 7 years ago.
Oh, wow.
So I've been around for a while, but never making conspiracy content. My wife, who met me in high school, she was one of the people who I told horrible things were horrible things were coming our way, and and she
it's
was traumatized.
Suck. Do you want to go through it together?
Yeah, exactly. And I was lucky enough that she said yes, but she's always been an advocate of saying, like, hey, this is what you're good at. You should be talking about this. And I have always tempered my unhinged schizophrenic ideas with reason, believe it or not. And I never felt comfortable espousing one thing or another until we had our really awesome experiences as a planet during 2020, 2021. Yeah. And I was on the right side of everything because of all that prior information that we discussed at the top of the show.
Because of
and
doing
so when
research?
That happened, I felt, yeah, oh yeah, yeah. Absolutely. And so from the jump, honestly, when it first happened, I said, this isn't what everybody's saying it's going to be. And I was wrong. You know, I thought that it was going to be because we had all these prior swine flu, Ebola, Zika virus, all yeah. these different things came. I thought that they were going to be it, and they just passed us by. And so I actually kind of tempered it with, well, I don't want to be wrong again. Bet you this isn't going to be it. And then lo and behold, it was. So, right. But once I realized what was happening, I was able to position myself on the right side of pretty much every move, every obstacle that we were faced with. Once that happened, I had a sense of vindication, started to make content that was conspiratorial, and Top ended up actually listening to an episode of mine, a show that I did called The Raven's Watch, which I no longer do. I'm hoping to bring it back once we make content creation a full-time occupation, then I'll have the time to do it. But it was me exploring, you know, various conspiracy topics, much more in the personal testimony arena. So people who have had experiences, I would have them on, they would share their stories, and I would ask questions because I have a sort of a Rolodex of information from which I ask questions from. I have good context for a lot of people's strange and bizarre experiences, and I can help them connect dots. And so he heard an episode or two of that and was actually impressed enough to take a chance on me, who he didn't know from anybody else. And, you know, the rest is history. Since then, we've started Nephilim Death Squad and have just really taken off. You know, we just did a live show called Bohemian Grove with Sam Tripley and a bunch of other nice. Really awesome content creators. And we're actually on the cusp of starting either a weekly or a bi-weekly show at a club on stage, you know, with a live audience. Awesome. So it's only growing from there. It's been a bizarre experience, really.
Awesome. I like it. And I look forward to seeing what you guys do. I know it's still pretty fresh, but it sounds like you got a lot going on. Leon in the chat says, since when do you have to worry about marketing to tell the truth? This is all yelling for the most part, by the way. About demon-infested frauds. This is totally the 100% debunked or Illuminati-confirmed type screed. But welcome back to my channel, Conspiracy Folk. I've missed you. Now, if you would like to leave a chat and have us read it, put in all caps fake super chat, just shout it out as Conspiracy Folk do. And because I'm not allowed to take money, you're not allowed to give me money because YouTube hates you and they hate me and they hate everything that has any value. But yeah, put it in all caps fake super chat and we'll try to get to it and probably give you crap for your bad ideas. But yeah, again, I don't want to spend too much time on your backstory. We'll get into that some other time because we are running out of time as a species and as a planet. But that has nothing to do with any of these articles that we're going to talk about. They have nothing to do with each other, as I mentioned at the beginning of the show. So let's get into some of this. So I just typed in Eclipse state of emergency, and Governor Sanders declares state of emergency ahead of Eclipse. We've got, this is a home video of a total solar eclipse, blah, blah, blah. Let's see. State of emergency declared New York City's solar eclipse, April 8th. So there's, you know, just as we've been through a few eclipses in our time, I feel like, and there are some things that make this one unique, and we're going to get to some of those. But before we do, let's talk about unrelated things like Iceland's violent volcanic flare-up triggering a state of emergency. This has nothing to do with the eclipse or the end of the world at all, but it's just a coincidence that there's volcanoes erupting in Iceland. Any thoughts so far, Raven?
It's interesting because I often try to temper my, like I said, my unhinged schizophrenic tendencies with kind of like reason and balance. And you go, is my attention being drawn to these things because of, let's just say in this particular instance, this ensuing eclipse is drumming up a lot of concern for a lot of people, and rightfully so. But does that mean then that internet sleuths or, for example, journalists might see a sort of a leverageable opportunity to show people other horrifying events and say, look, right. Is this connected somehow? Because, you know, it doesn't take a genius to say that people will draw correlation where I'm not saying there is none, but sometimes there isn't any. So I don't know which way I lean on this. It does feel like we just had the earthquake.
I don't know what you're implying. I'm saying that these things aren't related. Why are you insisting the opposite? They're not related.
And I agree. That's much more the side that I err on. These things are not related at all. Like that particular image.
It's like the Statue of Liberty getting struck by lightning yesterday. It's not related. It's just another thing that just happens to happen on the same weekend of all this stuff.
Yeah. And, take that however you want. There's an earthquake in New Jersey, and that's probably unrelated. I don't think that that's really a big deal, honestly. I used to live in New Jersey, and you know, I remember there being earthquakes all the time. This is an interesting one because
earthquakes
right there,
in New Jersey, earthquakes in New York, and earthquakes in Taiwan is what we've got here.
Which is like, last I checked, New Jersey is kind of the earthquake central of the world, really. So it's really not that strange. And then this one right here was interesting because right here we have it listed as 7.4. I don't know if you've noticed, these things happen on a sliding scale. One article will say 7. Blah blah blah. Another one will say 7. This and that. So I woke up that morning, the morning of this Taiwanese earthquake, to find that this is a real article. And maybe I could even pull it up on my phone here so I could read it to you. But and it was given to me by Skype, so who knows how valid that is. But it was a really interesting set of coincidences. Here we go. I think I have it. Okay. So Taiwan's strongest earthquake in 25 years is a 7.7. And as we said, these things seem to slide around for some reason. But Reuters, in this particular case, said 7.7. And it killed 7 people. And it trapped 77 people. And it injured 700 people. And it was the strongest earthquake in 25 years, which if you really want to reach 5 plus 2, 25, 5 plus 2 equals 7. I don't know what to make of that. Is Reuters just cherry picking? Are they orchestrating this thing that's sensational? Because the idea that it wasn't actually 78 people that got trapped, you know, or that the earthquake wasn't a 7.5 or a 7.4, but Reuters chooses to go with a 7.7, 77 people trapped, 7 people dead, 700 people injured, and it's the strongest one in 25 years. 5 plus 2 equals 7. So very strange, very strange. But these things, like you said, not connected.
Not at all. Let's go back to this video that I played at the top of the show, where they're going through the different numerology stuff, because I've had people on who are completely sold on the numerology stuff. I don't know. I think there's some stuff behind it. I find it fascinating. But there are some times where it's like, well, you saw, like, patterns are one thing, but if you saw two numbers that are the same, that doesn't really spark anything. There's some people who go way too deep into that and think that numbers are everything. But when you do have these things like you just said, the 7 and the 7 and the 7 and the 7, and then we've got this eclipse stuff. It seems to have a lot of numerology, too. I don't know if there's anything to it. You decide for yourself. Let's play a little bit of this, with audio, preferably.
An eclipse that took place 7 years ago went right across America. There's another eclipse coming right across America. It'll make a perfect cross on the center of the nation.
God made the first sign go through 7 cities named...
Now, I got to say, all of this feels very reminiscent to me. My dad was a pastor, so I heard all the predictions and all the world has ended at least 10 or 15 times in my lifetime. So I'm of two mindsets where I'm intrigued by it and want to see where this goes and have a little fun with it. And, you know, we might die on Monday, but I've seen this so many times. And all of this, even with, like, we can just go ahead and cut the these things aren't related act and just have a conversation. But with this eclipse thing, it feels so reminiscent of those days, because it's still like the mega pastors talking about, like the boomer pastors being like, well, clearly it's this because the Bible says this. And it's like, well, you sound like, what was his name? John Hagee back in 2015 about the blood moons and all that. Like, these things right. have come and gone so many times. That
do you remember Harold Camping? Harold Camping was another one. He broke down like the numerological, I don't know if I made that word up just now, value of the Bible, and thought there was a hidden code within it, and used that code to determine that, you know, the end was nigh. And I lived in New Jersey and saw his billboards by Woodbridge Mall.
We talked about him on this show.
Yeah, and I would see, and it would be like, the end is coming. Yep. We've figured out the Bible code. And so,
since
and then
the
Harold
show
Camping
has started
after that.
Case in point, since this show has started years ago, there has been at least one or two end times prophecies in that amount of time. So take that however you want. But like you said, with the COVID thing, there had been so many of those too, so many pandemics. And then you're like, oh, well, this one's obviously not it either. I don't want to like give people false hope and be like, well, this is clearly nothing just like the rest were, and then have it be, you know, with all this, the rest of the stuff that we're going to get into. And there's a lot here that we're going to go through, just different possibly unrelated coincidences, along with, you know, 2030 agendas and world governments and such things that people have been speaking about for end times prophecies since before I was born. But yeah, let's watch a little bit more of this.
Salem on August 21st, 2017.
The word Salem, according to Bible, is peace. So God is saying...
So this is from the 2017 eclipse, the last time this happened, which wasn't that long ago, but it's apparently not going to happen again for like 200 years or something like that. So big deal that it happened in 2017, and they were talking about the eclipse was passing over seven cities in America named Salem. And this is another point that makes this feel boomerish to me, is that it's very, very, very focused on America. Like, it's very like, this is what's happening in America, and God chose America as its chosen people. And so, you know, it matters where the sun's going in America, because we named these cities, a weird thing. But it went over seven cities named Salem back then, and he's gonna tell the rest.
Times he offered peace. The next eclipse is coming. It goes through several cities here, particularly Nineveh. So first we have seven cities called Salem, and now seven cities called Nineveh. Seven and seven. Seven cities called Salem, seven cities called Nineveh, and 7 years apart. Right in the center of the cross is a city called Rapture. What is God's message? He's coming very, very soon.
So I like to play devil's advocate on the show, even though I'm into all this stuff. But like, so it passed over seven cities in America named Salem. Now it's passing over, 7 years later, it's passing over seven cities named Nineveh, which, why do we have, who named a city Nineveh? Did you not read?
I'd be interested in knowing. Yeah, exactly. Like, who made that call? That's a strange call to make. You know what's interesting? I don't know if you can see, pull that back right there on my arm. I have the number 7, and it's because I was born on July 7th, 1990, which is the 7th month and the 7th day of the month. And it was a Saturday, being the 7th day of the week. Now, that has not in any way applied to my life, like in any functional way that I can, Illuminati confirmed, I knew it. There's no way that I can fit that in. It's just a tattoo. I was like, it's kind of cool. I like the number 7. Also, not a lucky guy. As far as gambling goes, I have lost money only one time and then never gambled again. It was so brutal. I got my ass handed to me. So I mean, you know, when you say it feels boomery, it feels like a reach. It does feel like what I've learned as a, at this point, I can say it confidently, a professional conspiracy theorist, is if I want to, I can make anything fit.
Right.
I really can. I can bend things a little bit in a way that still seems justified, and I can kind of mold it to my liking and cover it in a narrative.
It's going over those cities, but it also went over a billion other cities. Like, and maybe there was like,
right,
how many Springfields did it go over? Why didn't we determine that, because there were 25 Springfields that it went over, that God was talking to us about springing up in the field, and we're all gonna blow, like, this is how
you
the whole thing,
you can definitely, yes,
bend it however you want,
you can tweak it a little bit. Yep. So okay, but you said it before too, it's like, I don't want to do the COVID thing again. I don't want to do that again. Right. Because I was, as you know, how much that sucked in the very beginning, for the first 4 to 5, maybe a week of it happening. I was living in Las Vegas at the time. It's going around in the news and I'm going, this is nothing. And then for it to actually have been something, I felt kind of foolish because it was like I should have, if anybody should have seen this coming that I knew personally, it should have been me. So that being said, you know, we are in unprecedented times when it comes to, I don't know if you're aware of this, but the very location that the X is formed over, where it intersects, is where they found the red heifers.
Oh, I did not know that.
Yeah, so that's a little strange. And I mean, we do have, once again, to go along with this kind of pattern here, Israel is gearing up to build the third temple. And they are, for the first time in a long time, we're seeing
a Hold on. We're going to get to the red heifers. We're going to get to all that. We got to get through a couple more coincidences before we get to the glaringly horrifying going on.
All right, so let's play... we can continue to play plausible deniability.
Yes.
For a while, then let's do that.
Completely unrelated. There's a plague of locusts coming to the United States. Cicada geddon insect invasion will be the biggest bug emergence in centuries. Apparently, it's going to happen, especially in Illinois and in Chicago, which is where I am. So that should be fun. Where are you located again, Raven?
I'm in Florida, but I gotta say, man, this is the first time I'm hearing anybody bring up the cicada thing. I'm aware that we're due for an unprecedented emergence of cicadas. And I don't know about you, but like when I was a kid, my grandmother, when I was really young, because I said she passed away when I was six. So when I was a little boy, she used to put them on my shirt, like the carcass, the shells of them. And I'd run around and I'd have them all stuck to my shirt. My wife is mortified when I do it to my son, but they've always had a special place to me. Cicadas have always been special to me because of that.
I didn't realize they disappeared. I had that too as a child. I remember the shells and all that. It was gross, but I didn't realize that they went away. So them coming back, I mean, them coming back, good nostalgia, but more than 1 trillion cicadas will emerge in the U.S. this year. That might be a bit too much nostalgia. That's like Disney level nostalgia where you're like, okay, bud, chill.
And I'm learning that nostalgia is not so great for us, especially our generation. I think there's an effort to keep us what is the expression? Adult adolescence for the rest of our lives. Yeah. But I remember when I was living in New Jersey, we had an emergence because there's a 7-year cicada and there's a 17-year cicada and there might be other ones. But I know that while I was in New Jersey, not so many years ago, maybe 7, there was an emergence of some annual cicada, and I had never seen it to this degree. I thought when I was looking in the streets that I was seeing leaves, like in the fall, bunched up against the curbs in the streets. And in reality, it was actually cicada carcasses.
It was a horde.
And the noise was deafening. At one point, I pulled on the branch of a tree, and a swarm came down. And they are kind of retarded. Cicadas will just dive bomb you and thud and fall to the ground. They're harmless, really. So it's not like it was scary. I already knew what they were about, but I had never seen them in that number. So if we're going to experience, you know, something that, you know, hitherto has been, you know, unseen, I expect that to be pretty significant, because what I saw in New Jersey, I was taken back. I was like, wow, that's an incredible amount of cicada bodies, dude. So maybe I'm kind of excited. I don't know. I'm weird like that. You know, I don't want to go too far down this trail, but I don't get blackpilled. The stranger things get, the more like amped I get. Like it's fun.
Like, great,
it's
I got exciting. A show this week. Awesome.
Yes, exactly. Content is just crushing. And also I just feel like if things are really unfolding in a biblical nature, well, guess what, guys? That's kind of that's good news. You know, it's probably the best case scenario.
Did Israel pay you to say that?
Yes.
It's good news, you guys.
Brought to you by Israel. You know, but that's really interesting. I bet you there's somebody out there that has a real body of information when it comes to the symbolic significance of the cicada and how this plugs into end time prophecy, as seemingly all things do right now plug into end times prophecy.
I mean, when you live it all kind of ties together. But a couple fake super chats here. Libertarians for RFK say, fake super chat, Christ is king. Get out of here with your anti-Semitic
Nazi fags.
Bullshit. Brent Lewis says, fake super chat, demon frogs squatted in my home and the police won't remove them. Now I have to sleep behind a dumpster as the frogs destroy my property. Thanks, Dan.
Change the locks. Try changing the locks.
Yeah. Are they gay frogs?
They're all gay frogs now.
Well, yeah. Hector Ruse, speaking of cave frogs. Sorry, Hector. Says, fake super chat. celestial phenomenon are signs of electrical universe triggering earthquakes, hurricanes, etc. Google Space Weather News. Now, I'm curious, like, with the eclipse, I'm wondering, like, let's say it's not the end of days, and it's just the eclipse does fuck with the weather and nature and all this stuff, and so we're having these different cataclysmic events. That's a possibility, but the thing that, I don't know, the thing that's been strange to me is all of these different, like, states of emergency that are being announced. Like, I've got one here, one second. In Dayton, there was one, let me pull this up, from the Dayton Police and Fire. As we approach the solar eclipse on Monday, April 8th, there are several things you should be aware of. Buy enough food and water to last a few days before April 8th in case you are unable to get to the store or you can't find what you are looking for. Fill your car with gas before April 8th in case you're stuck in traffic or unable to get to a gas station. Be prepared for possible delays to have food or gas restocked. Now, let's say, let's go with their narrative. It's just an eclipse. Why is Dayton concerned about a massive flooding of people? Like if this was the Super Bowl, they wouldn't say, go out and stock up on food and water. I would imagine there are more people that flood into the Super Bowl than flood into Dayton, Ohio to see an eclipse.
I got to say, the number of comments right there is concerning. 33 comments, Illuminati confirmed. I am actually surprised that I have not seen any announcements of state of emergency until you started pulling them up. And as you were pulling them up even earlier in the show, I was counting like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So yep, that actually surprises me. I guess if you wanted to play sort of the vanilla route on here, you would say that people are panicky and dumb. What's that line? There's a line from
people
Men in Black.
People are dumb, panicky, dangerous animals, and you know it. A person is smart.
And you know it. Yes. And so, I mean, maybe that is the angle that they're taking, that all these, you know, retards are going to look at end times prophecy and they're going to freak out. Possible. But sometimes I do
wonder.
It feels
like they're creating the panic, though.
Exactly. So there's a propaganda wing of the American government, or of all governments. If you're worth your salt at all, you have a propaganda wing. If you don't, then what the hell are you doing? But it seems that they are stoking the fire with, you know, any number of things that they want to poke us with. And so when I see that state of emergency, I mean, I wasn't going to keep my son home on Monday. Now I'm thinking, like, maybe we can have a fun eclipse day. I don't know. Maybe we can do fun sort of family events or family games, have a family game night where it's like, hey, who can look at the eclipse the longest? I don't know what we'll do.
Go stare
at
the sun with your
kids. Out of it. Yeah, exactly. That's kind of good old fashioned fun. And so I didn't know they were doing that, honestly, though, dude. I didn't see that until you started going through it. And I'm, you know, nothing really freaks me out these days, but I definitely things still make me go, hmm. And that's one of them. I go, well, that's interesting. Yeah. Seems like you wouldn't want to do that. If you had any vested interest in keeping sort of the peace amongst people, you would go like, hey, guys, it's just an eclipse. Quit being crazy. And they just let that slide. But instead, declaring states of emergency. I did scroll through Facebook earlier today and I saw, you know, a bunch of people talking about keeping their kids home on the 8th. So something I hadn't considered. But maybe it's a good move. Maybe everybody should just take Monday off and bring the economy to a grinding halt. See what happens.
It deserves it anyway. So in a completely unrelated news, NASA, who we all know and trust, they're firing atmospheric perturbations around eclipse path, also known as APEP rockets at the eclipse. And as Tim Pool pointed out on Twitter, APEP, Apep, Apepi, Apophis, was the ancient Egyptian spirit of evil, darkness, and destruction as the archenemy of the sun god Ra. He was a malevolent force who could never be entirely vanquished. Every night as the sun traveled through the underworld or across the sky, his roar would fill the air and he would launch his attack. So NASA decided, I don't know, do you think that it's a stretch to say that Apep is named after Apophis?
Well, there's an article, and you can look it up. I know it included terminology where it was actually laughable. It was like NASA is conducting a operation with a very scientific sounding name. And that was actually the verbiage that they used, scientific sounding name.
Of course.
And it later on went to describe, yes, big brain energy. And it went on to describe the operation as, I'm paraphrasing here, whether it's project or operation, but afterwards was serpentine deity. So we're talking Project Serpentine Deity or Operation Serpentine Deity. So I guess there's other names that this project goes by or whatever the case may be. But I was something got in my brain the other day and I decided to look up Revelations 12. And it was interesting because it's talking about and I'm not saying this is a connection here. We're talking specifically about unconnected things or unrelated things. And so,
of course,
in that spirit, I bring this up. But it was, you know, Revelations 12 goes on to describe a woman who is shrouded in sunlight, whose feet are in the moon, and who is set upon by a red dragon who waits for her to give birth so that it may devour the child. And I started just thinking about the way an eclipse looks, where it's shrouded in sunlight around the edges, but, you know, is set in the moon. I thought about the symbolism of what a woman might be. And a woman is, you know, really for nothing more than just a birth canal. Like, that's really all women are. It's just a birth canal. The portal by which all things enter this realm, right? And so if you think about this, a lot of people will tell you that they believe that this eclipse is going to be a portal of sorts, right? And so, but the real icing on the cake is when you get to this red dragon that is going to set upon her and wait for her to birth a child so that it may devour it. And what are we doing? We're launching three rockets
right
at the shadow of the moon in a project that is called to some extent Project Serpentine Deity. So I mean, once again, it's like, is NASA just having a laugh? Like, are they having a lol? Are they really just trolling us, or is there something else going on here?
They've got nothing better to do.
I don't know,
space,
man.
space is fake
and space is gay. So with all that money that we give them, I think it's something like $33 trillion annually, they go, why don't we just launch rockets at the shadow? And they say that it's to take atmospheric anomaly recordings or something of that nature. Sure. And it just seems strange. They want to know what the atmosphere is like in the shadow of the moon during the presence of a solar eclipse. And it's like, okay, maybe.
Can you name it something else? Can you name it like,
I mean,
Operation Eclipse Investigation? I don't know. The options are limitless, and you chose.
We don't pay you
Death
to
God.
Be
yes.
We pay you to investigate the gay and fake space.
Yes. We pay you to pretend to be astronauts.
That's it, man. So I'm excited because I am in Florida. NASA operates out of Florida. I hope, I think there's another one in Texas, some sort of other NASA facility in Texas, but I believe the main one is here in Florida. So hopefully I'll be able to see this red serpent launch into this potential portal situation and, you know, destroy or devour whatever entity plans on coming through. I don't know what's going on, but yeah, we're starting to build a case here, Dan.
Yeah.
We're building an interesting body of work here, Dan, where it's like,
I'm not making
any,
you
know,
case.
We've got,
I'm just asking questions.
You're inadvertently, I don't know if you've noticed, but you're painting a picture here. You're doing it with a blindfold. You have no intentions of painting this picture, but still you are painting a very compelling picture, right?
I do. I'm just supposed to pretend like I'm not on YouTube because they don't like these pictures
right.
that we're painting. Yes.
Right. And you know, if you happen to accidentally paint a picture, Dan, that's not your fault. But seven cities named Salem, seven cities named Nineveh. The X, and we'll get to that, is where the red heifer was found. It's 7 years ago that happened, and it's 7 years afterwards that another one is about to happen. NASA is launching serpentine deities, and it happens to sound a lot like scripture from Revelations. There's something really, really interesting. You know, it's kind of like paint by numbers, where we've only got a couple of colors that we're using so far, and we're going, this is looking like something. We've connected a couple of dots, and right now we're trying to guess what the picture is.
Oh, man. Yeah, kind of. But you know who else painted pictures? Adolf Hitler.
Right.
So, you know, confirmed Nazi. Drugs for Robots says, fake super chat. By the way, the LPTX is having its convention. Who cares about libertarians today? On April 12th.
Unbelievable.
The world is ending. And you're still telling me about libertarian shit? It's convention on April 12th at Corpus Christi. By the way, Christ is King.
Nazi fags.
Sorry. We don't allow that kind of hate speech around here. Now, we gotta... So, back to the eclipse a little bit here. This is from timeout.com, so you know it's legit. The solar eclipse 2024 warnings. Here's the full list you need to know ahead of April 8th. Just gonna go through a bit of this. When is the 2024 solar eclipse? Basically tomorrow. What emergency warnings have been issued? Don't watch and drive. Some schools are closed. Stock up on food. Warning for flights and airports. So the FAA has also issued a warning for flights and airports. Travelers might experience
delays. Can we go back to this real quick? Sure. I'm sorry to interrupt. I just want to see this right here. You can stop it right there. Crowds of tourists heading to areas of totality like Texas, Kentucky, Ohio, and New York are the root of the other major. Okay, so it's basically saying that you want to stock up on food and supplies because
tourists are going to
mm-hmm. mob to your – the tourists are coming, and so prepare yourself because the tourists are – okay, all right.
There was one city in particular that I heard was in a state of emergency. I don't have the article pulled up, but they're in a state of emergency because of the tourists coming, and it was Temple, Texas. Nothing to see there.
Interesting.
I wonder if after the tourists destroy it, they'll rebuild it in 3 days. Just curious. The FAA has also issued a warning for flights and airports. So, why are flights being delayed? Why are some schools closing? Well, it says due to transportation issues. I suppose I should read the articles before I start talking about them.
Well, it's a weird move, though, isn't it? It's like this whole thing is going to be a very it's like 6 minutes or something like that. Is it 7 minutes? So you're going to fly to a state that's going to experience totality so that you can really – like, what are you going to do afterwards? I want to see – the hundreds of thousands, maybe millions of people who are going to fly to these places, look up in the air for 6 minutes, and then they're going to go, all right, let's go to our local Steak and Shake and just mob the shit out of it and congest everything. And they're going to have a terrible time. Hopefully whatever happens, that's the end for them right there. Not because I want them to die, but because you have to have like a climactic moment. Like you didn't go all this way to just not, you know, to have your retina burned out of your skull and then to go to Dairy Queen. Like you have to be smited right there or raptured or whatever's going to happen to you. I hope that for their sake, it's worth the trip and something cool happens, like a rapturing.
Yeah. Make it worth the trouble, you know? Like if you spent all your money to go watch a 6 minute natural event, then it's probably best that this all be done because, you know, we've had a good run. It's fine. I can't see a damn thing in these. I hope they work great. Do you have your specs, Raven?
I have a welding shield because I am a welder by trade, but I think
just do what Donald Trump does and squint really hard.
That's what I don't even think I'm going to squint. I think I'm going to keep my eyes wide open. I'm going to pull a Donald Trump. I'm not going to let that man out alpha me. I'll be staring at the eclipse. I don't recommend that anybody else do it because I plan on absorbing all of the eclipse energy and I don't want to share it. So yeah, I'm going to be looking straight at it. Or at least what I'm going to do is try to look at it in my peripheral and then get a little bit closer and a little bit closer till I'm looking at it dead on. I'm going to creep up on it. I'm not just going to kind of full frontal it at first. But I'm not even lying. I do want to look at it. I want to know. I want to know what Donald Trump knows.
Yeah. You know, I should probably get, I do video work. I should probably get a really, really good polarizing filter and just crank that shit down and film this. Film the end of the world, and then there can be found
footage.
Or you go
to Harbor Freight. If you go to Harbor Freight and you get a lens insert for a welding shield, they're very cheap. You could just lay it right over. We did that one time with the camera, and that's how we took a picture. And we got a good picture, so I think if you did it with a good camera, you'd probably be all right.
That's not a bad idea. Now, this article ends with, why have there been so many warnings about the solar eclipse? And basically, they're just saying everybody wants to see this. I don't know. I remember a bunch of these solar events in my lifetime, and I don't remember there being this much interest or fear or anything about them. They just happened. And then you looked up or you didn't look up, and we all moved on with our day. Who is traveling to see the eclipse? I don't know.
Well, this particular one is like the first one in what, like 240 years or something like that. Like this style, this flavor of Eclipse. I'm not very familiar with the flavors of Eclipse because
they make them up.
That space.
I feel like they make it up.
They do just make them up.
Like, I feel like every few years they're like, this is the only time this has ever happened. And then a couple years later, they're like, this is the only time this has ever happened. And it's like, it's the same fucking thing. The moon passed in front of the sun.
It's the same thing. It's the same way they make up national holidays. Like, there's another holiday. Like, today's National Oreo Day. Tomorrow is National Truck Driver Day. Like, they
and they're
just
all
are
National
making up
LGBTQ Day, for what it's worth.
Every single one of them, all of them are that primarily, and then there's secondary days. But the same way they make those up on the fly is the same way they make up, you know, solar events, I swear. Because I don't really – I agree. It seems like every other day there's this once-in-a-lifetime opportunity to – actually miss some shit in the sky, because every time I'm like, oh, tonight's gonna be the super duper extravaganza moon, I can't right. wait to see it, the moon's gonna be purple with a silver lining, and then I look up
clouds.
And I go, shit, it's cloudy, I can't see the super duper extravaganza moon. So hopefully this
every
isn't
time.
Like that
cloudy every
it
time
is, dude.
thank you
it is.
Now we're gonna go deeper, we're gonna go darker, and we're going to get into things like CERN and heifers and stuff. But before that, I have to remind you about a very important sponsor, Lone Star Injury Attorneys. Have you or a loved one been injured by some fuck nuggets, reckless driving, a tumble at your shitty job, or some other form of dumb shit outside of your control? Well, fear not, because today's episode is sponsored by a lawyer. Lone Star Injury Attorneys is an award-winning personal injury law firm that achieves maximum results for its injured clients. Max the Axe is not just a lawyer, but a hardcore Mises Caucus libertarian and also a big supporter of this show and all of our bullshit. Max is the best personal injury lawyer in Texas, but don't judge him by his occupation or location. Max is an avid defender of liberty and justice in whatever state you got fucked in. If you've been injured and your ass needs saving, go with the pros at Lone Star Injury Attorneys. Visit LoneStarInjuryAttorneys.com or Google Max the Axe. Consultations are free and you don't pay a single dime unless you win. Once again, go to LoneStarInjuryAttorneys.com and get your ass covered.
And we are back. Welcome back to the end of the world. Now, there's been a lot of talk in all of this, in all of the conspiracy theories and all the craziness, all the schizophrenia that's going around this eclipse. There's a lot of talk about CERN, and we haven't talked about CERN in a while, but CERN's always, you know, they're always out there doing whatever CERN does, looking for ghost particles and God particles and all sorts of particles, trying to open portals to hell and, you know, normal science things. But Raven, thoughts on CERN? Do you think CERN's related to any of this? Because I'm getting mixed reviews here. Some people saying it's definitely not happening. They're definitely not launching it back up, and others saying that they definitely are launching it back up. So I don't know how to feel.
Well, I pulled up an article and I posted it on my Twitter. I don't have it on hand, but I did find an article definitively saying that they plan to collide the particles. Apparently, the way my very rudimentary brain, my rudimentary thought process understands this concept is that you got to let the machine warm up. So they actually fire up the machine days ahead of time and they begin the process of accelerating these particles, and that they plan to collide them on the 8th. So, I mean, you know, things could have changed. The article that I saw, honestly, I think was from January of 2024. And so maybe plans have changed since then. But as far as I'm concerned, I've not seen anything that suggests that. So, I mean, we're talking the same organization that is intrinsically tied to the Mandela effect, right? These are people that everybody suspects is altering the fabric of our very reality.
We'll
and
play a bit
I
of the opening ceremony here in a bit.
Yeah, with Shiva. Have you seen this whole thing right there? So, I mean, you know, and there's always this, it never seems to fail. Whenever you have a big conspiracy about a government body or a scientific body, there is always this backdrop of ceremony and ritual. It's always right behind the scenes. It's like, why do they need to do a ceremony at the foot of a giant statue of Shiva? Yeah. It doesn't make any sense at all. And they kind of really go into very strange directions with it. And I know that in Sweden, which is where I believe CERN is, there's no shortage of like really bizarre sort of entity worship rituals that they do and festivals that they have. And so
a lot of midsummer shit.
That's a great way of putting it, dude. A lot of midsummer shit. And so when it comes to CERN, I mean, right now we're building a layer cake that probably it's not. There we go. Dude, can we press play on this? Because this is insane.
I've got a few of them. Yeah. And this is, to be fair, I'm pretty sure. So if I recall correctly, the Goddard Tunnel, which is linked to the CERN, like conspiracy people, including myself, link this directly to CERN. Everybody says this is the CERN opening ceremony. I'm not entirely sure which exactly, but they're linked very closely. And this is all, you know, scientific shit. And I've got a couple right. clips here. Science!
This is how you get the scientific juices flowing. This is why American scientists suck. Because yep.
we don't dance around in Baphomet costumes. Yeah, if only we were a little bit more satanic in our science, maybe we would have found that vaccine a little bit faster. Try again, Donald Trump.
Right.
But let's watch a little bit more, because there's...
Operation Warp Speed my ass.
Yeah, this is all, like, I was talking to, well, my lady, and she's, like, conspiracy-minded completely, and she's more into revisionist history and much more intelligent on most of this stuff than I am. She wasn't familiar with CERN, so this is for her benefit. I've talked about this extensively on the show. CERN stuff, and especially this video here, which is, again, completely scientific. So for the audio listener,
what you're about to see,
well, just let this guy describe
the
it.
Workers in a zombie-like trance. It's pretty freaky.
I like his commentary better anyway. Pretty freaky, bro.
Pretty freaky. I like that this is preceded by the king of science arriving on horseback.
Yes. Is it Dr. Fauci shirtless?
Very strange. Everybody's coming in this zombified state. I mean, what now, is strange to me is that none of these people seem to be leaking anything. Like, hey, I was part of the CERN ceremony, and this is what we were told to do, and this is why. I would like to speak to those people. Is it really that they speak Swedish or Deutsch, and we just don't hear from them because we don't speak the same language? Where are these people?
Yeah, where's the translator or the AI that's interpreting this to figure out what they're talking about here? Because I had a point, and it's gone. It's gone entirely. But I remember what it was.
This is what we call. Go ahead.
So we can scrutinize this satanic bullshit here. We can scrutinize all day long and say that it's not scientific or whatever. But imagine the person, the guy that who's like his dream was to be like to make like theater sets or performance art or something, and they hired him to be this. To make this, to create this beautiful, amazing, like eccentric and very intrinsic Satan worshiping science experiment ceremony. There's something about it that I'm kind of envious of, but you know.
Well, the way that I was going to describe, Dan, this is what Top and I on Nephilim Death Squad, we call this Nephilim shit. And Nephilim shit is just a catch-all term for anything that is suspicious of the esoteric nature. I mean, it's also got other utilities when it comes to things that are just societally corrosive. You might call a man shitting in the streets. You might say that that is Nephilim shit. Not because the shit itself is Nephilim, but because this is bad for society. This is a sign of the downfall. But this in particular, this is peak Nephilim shit. And when it comes to these things, I can't help but think, because we're a society here in the West that, and I think all over the world is really, our experience in this reality is intrinsically ritualistic. It's intrinsically ceremonial. There is esoteric occult symbolism around every corner, embedded in everything we do, especially on the largest scale. So when you're talking about whatever's going on at CERN, or when you're talking about the Super Bowl halftime shows, or, you know, whatever the hell Taylor Swift is doing, or whatever the hell Hollywood is doing, or the, you know, the rest of the music industry, or this whole Diddy debacle, right? It's all of this stuff. There is a dark, esoteric nature behind everything. And I think that the function of it is, and if you're talking about CERN, I think this applies. This is like an energy capturing ritual. Mm-hmm. The same way My co-host Top Lobster has talked to me about it. He used to play guitar in the church. Yeah. And he said that there was something almost like warming up the crowd, getting the congregation in the right state of mind to be able to receive the word, right? Sure. And I think that these ceremonies are very similar. They are priming almost the entire atmosphere of this area, preparing it, this part of the planet, whatever, to accept what's about to happen. And yeah. then oftentimes these rituals are preceding the initiation of the large particle collider. And then, you know, whatever's happening afterwards. I mean, I remember articles coming out really early when I was younger, still probably maybe in my early 20s, reading articles about CERN and what are their intentions. And it's like, well, we want to recreate the moment of the Big Bang and expose particles that only would have been. Yeah, really. but to expose particles that only would have been able to have been seen or detected at that very moment. And then we're going to take a bunch of high speed photos of that moment to try to detect Higgs boson, whatever the hell it is. And or we're going to open up like a black hole.
Win-win, you know?
I don't know if you've seen this, Dan. Are you familiar with Nick Hinton?
Mm-mm.
Nick Hinton is a great conspiracy content creator. And I recommend everybody follow him on Twitter. He posts a lot of really interesting information. But one of the things that he said recently, and he linked articles to it, and I read the articles, and I didn't know how to take it. It was like, well, CERN is concerned that they may have encountered a four-dimensional ghost, I believe is the language that they use, ghost or entity, but I think it was ghost because I found that strange, and that this thing, they have it trapped, and it's blocking what they think might be the entrance to another realm. And I'm reading the article, and I'm going, what are you talking about? You have a CERN, can...
Is that related to the ghost particle that they've been looking for? They were looking for the God particle, then the ghost particle? Is that related?
I think you said that at the top of the show, and it's mm-hmm. what sparked that memory in me. And this is only very recently that I read this article. So found a ghost haunting the world's most famous particle accelerator. Boom, yep. There we go. Popular Mechanics. Very interesting. Let's see. CERN superproton synchro. What? How do you say that? Synchrotron. I like that. That's a very scientific sounding.
It's very Transformers. Word. Yeah.
So Germany announced that they isolated a resonant ghost that affects how particles behave inside the superproton synchrotron. It's a 3D shape that shifts over time, meaning it's best measured in 4D. So this is interesting because this language is putting me at ease. Where the it's just a 3D.
In case you're too at ease, you know.
It behaves like a 4D. It's not a big deal. Yeah. And then there's this.
In case
right?
you're too at right ease, here's the ceremony.
You know what's crazy, too? This ceremony, I believe I remember this one. There's like a fallen angel kind of character with a Bigfoot or a Sasquatch head, which is really
there's
bizarre.
Where the wild things are. I'm pretty sure that's what that creature is.
Which I always found horrifying. That was actually a scary book if you take it on its face as a child. Like, I don't know why this little girl or this little boy is so calm hanging out with these things.
Yeah, you're kidnapped by monsters in the middle of the night. I bet it's going to go great. Yep. It's all to build your confidence. But here's this again.
Happened yesterday in Switzerland. Put this together with CERN.
Yeah. All right, we don't need this guy's commentary. But yeah, fallen angels and, you know, naked zombies and demons and all sorts of things. Construction workers who seem to be male strippers, I don't really know. Like, I don't even know what the theme is exactly, other than, like, if you wanted to cause concern for your whole thing, this is the way to do it, because I don't know what the fuck this is, if not
who's
a ritual.
Doing this?
Like,
who's setting
I play
this
devil's
up?
Advocate, and I can't come up with a logical explanation for how this exists.
You know what? The only logical explanation I can come up with, outside of the fact that you should take this at face value and realize that CERN is trying to open portals to bring entities from, you know, this banished realm, this realm that they've been banished to, into this realm. The only other thing that I can give them is somebody's like, yo, how do we freak people out? And it's like, right. There's no rhyme or reason. They're just like, put the most insane shit.
Most fucked up shit.
What do you do? Okay, all right. Make one of them.
The
like,
satanic
give them
fever dream.
Right. Right. And then the other guy goes like, yo, put a gorilla head on the angel wing guy. That people won't know what the hell that means. And then there's another dude that's like, gay male strippers. Take the shirt. Construction workers, pop their shirts on. I only want dudes that are in shape. No fat dudes, only dudes that are in shape. And by the end of it, you have this thing where like, honestly, if I was part of that, I'd sit back and go, this is a masterpiece.
Fucking kill
this it. This is beautiful. The chaos that this is going to cause, the confusion that this is going to cause is beautiful.
Like, if it's a troll, it's a master troll that required, like, thousands of people to be involved in this. And, you know, we as conspiracy-minded folk, we always hear, like, well, if that were true, then thousands of people would have to be involved. Okay, motherfucker, well, here's thousands of people involved in the opening ceremony. I don't know. Like, we haven't heard a peep out of any of them being like, fucked up shit's going on here. It's like, I don't know. If somebody has, I'm open to it. If somebody has the logical explanation or the set designer's explanation as to why they did this, I'm open to it. It's fine. But it's odd that even this video is hard to find anymore. It's a miracle that it exists at all. But
can I say this, Dan?
Yeah.
So, you know, before we dismount and we go on to the next horrifying coincidence, people said for the longest time, just like they're saying now with CERN opening portals and causing the Mandela effect, for the longest time, people said, hey, the hip hop industry is rife with homosexuality and blackmail. And there were constant conspiracy theories about it. And there was constant anecdotal evidence. You'd get a picture of Lil Wayne kissing baby on the mouth, or you'd get this, or you'd get that. It didn't matter. Yeah. You were constantly inundated with stuff. There was always a body of evidence, and there was always a conversation. And for 30 years, P. Diddy ran an Epstein-style blackmail ring on the hip-hop industry. And only now are we finally being exposed to the idea that, like, oh, all your homies that were talking shit and that were conspiracy theorists and saying hip hop was gay and filled with all this weird crap, they were 100% correct.
Yeah.
So very much like what's happening now with this CERN thing, it's like, when are we going to find out that, like, oh yeah, because they say if it was really happening, there's no way that, right, like you said, would be able to keep these secrets. And you go, well, nobody was keeping the secrets.
Right.
They were all saying it out loud, and now were confirmed that everything that people were saying about Diddy and Wayne and Meek Mill and all this crazy shit, it was 100% true. This is only not true until the moment where everything that was said was 100% true. So how far are we from this
it's
sort
complete
of crescendo?
Bullshit until the point that they can't deny it and we prove that, you know,
exactly. Actually
those things that we've been saying for 10 years were, you know, not that crazy. And the beautiful gaslighting of you're the crazy one. If you notice that we're kind of like, if you even notice that we're kind of fucked up or really weird, like if you even pay attention to this, you're a crazy conspiracy theorist, which again means you're a white supremacist, which means you're anti-Semitic or whatever is the flavor of the day. But rest assured, according to USAtoday.com, no, CERN won't be opening a portal during the April 8th eclipse. That'd be impossible. Fact check. So USA Today has determined that CERN, they've got CERN figured out, and it would be absolutely impossible for that to happen.
Thank goodness.
Thank you. Thank you for that. And also,
I was worried.
Notice how their fact check is the straw man. It's like, if you think that they're opening a portal, that's false because that's impossible. Okay, I didn't say they're opening a portal. I said they're doing something, and there's a lot of shit going on. There's a lot of reasons not to trust CERN. That's it. But fact check, they're not opening a portal, or at least they're not trying to open a portal. At least they're not telling us that they're trying to open a portal. Okay, that would be impossible. Thank you, USA Today. But according to thedailymail.co.uk, signals legit, CERN to test world's most powerful particle accelerator during April's solar eclipse to search for invisible matter that secretly powers our universe. So, you know, just reasonable, normal stuff. They're not trying to open portals. They're just trying to find God particles and, I don't know, stuff that USA Today I don't think is any more qualified than we are to weigh in on and determine true or false.
Can I ask you this, Dan? Do you think that we've gotten to the point of, like, sort of, you know, the comedy of fact checking, the comedy of the fact check websites, the fact check articles, the snoping, like that has reached a critical mass where the cat is virtually out of the bag on that. Hey, guys, typically when they're fact checking you, like especially on the really conspiratorial stuff, they're just doing damage control in the lightest touch sort of way, where they just go, no, it's not true. It's
literally
bizarre.
Literally, this headline is CERN activating the world's most powerful particle accelerator for April 8th eclipse. No, they're not. Don't shut up. Don't worry about it.
Can we rewind the show 45 seconds?
Yep. Whatever. So there's that. There's CERN. I don't know if it's related. Doesn't matter if it's related. These are just completely unrelated things. As far as I can tell, if you put pieces together on your own, that's up to you. Now, other stuff that definitely has nothing to do with any of this, and this is more because you guys on Nephilim Death Squad get more into some of the biblical stuff and some of the religious stuff, which I appreciate and enjoy, and it definitely is worth a dig. But this doesn't have anything to do with the eclipse. There's just this whole red heifer thing that's going around in a country that's known for a lot of religious, you know, strife and combat and bombs and stuff. So do you want to explain? Well, actually, yeah, go ahead. Do you want to explain what you know about this red heifer thing, and then we'll get a couple other things on it.
So is it totally insignificant phenomenon of this red heifer, right? This red cow. There's basically prophecy that says that upon the finding of, I believe it's the 10th red heifer. So there have been historically 9 previous ones, or it might be 9 red heifers, and previously 8 have been found, but there hasn't been a red heifer found in many, many years. I want to say like it's either 200 or 2000 years.
I've got some videos that'll give us the details. I've got a couple clips. Great. But continue.
So essentially what happens is when this heifer is found, it has to be a blemishless red heifer. It can't have a single hair that's not red. It can't have a single deformity, abnormality. It can't be yoked, which is to say that it can't have been worked. It can't have been roughed up. It can't have been used to do anything.
It can't have been ridden or leaned on, even, is what I've heard.
Yes. And so for the longest time, and we'll get into it, maybe it is 2,000 years, we haven't found one. And then all at once, a couple of guys, I forget their names, but I actually listened to an entire podcast on a show called Blurry Creatures. Highly recommend that show for people that want to dig deeper into this. Find their red heifer episode. They actually spoke to the two gentlemen who discovered that there was a red heifer. And what ends up happening is they get in touch with all these rabbi and they go, hey, we found one in Texas. We finally found one.
They found five,
right? Well, first they had just found one and they were en route to its location when suddenly the farmer discovered what this was all about. And he said, hey, I don't want to be involved in this. I'm sorry, but we're not doing business. I gotta stay away from this. And so all of a sudden this moment falls through their hands, but the rabbi are already en route to this location.
Can you take a brief aside and explain what he was concerned about? Like, what is the prophecy? What is the point of the red heifer?
So the point of the red heifer is that once they find this 10th one, they can actually sacrifice this red heifer. And what they would do with it is, and I believe it's going to be live streamed, guys. Like, this is a reality. They have this.
Is it specific that it's the 10th one? Or, like, I heard that it was, like, they had found multiples throughout the years, but the Jewish people were not, they didn't have the temple ready, or they didn't have Jerusalem as the place.
No, so what actually happens is that they have to be a certain age, and I forget how many months it is. I want to say it's like 2 years old, but it's probably less than 2 years old. But whatever the idea is, they have to remain blemishless and perfect until a certain age. And oftentimes, well, every time, they've just developed something. You know, they'll develop a patch of fur that's white, or they'll, whatever the case may be, as they get older. Because when you have a calf, you can see that it's a perfect red heifer. Sure, that has happened before. But as it reaches maturity, it develops, you know, not abnormalities, but just typical cow shit. You know,
it's things less red.
Patch of fur here, it's less red, or, you know, it'll develop some sort of a marking somewhere, or, you know, it might have been yoked, but nothing has made it to the deadline, which
nothing has passed all the check boxes, and we got close. Have I heard correctly that they were trying to, like, engineer a red heifer too? Because, like, this red heifer is supposed to be symbolic for, uh, I to my understanding, like bringing back the Jewish Messiah, which from Christian theology would mean more like bringing the Antichrist forward and signaling the end times either way. But I heard that they were like trying to engineer this thing and create it on their own. I don't know if that's true, but all in all, it's like, so you're trying to create, to bring prophecy to pass, like it is in your hands to force God's hand to return and bring the Messiah or the Antichrist or the end times, whatever you think.
Correct. So basically what they would do is they would sacrifice this heifer, they would burn it, and they would use the ashes to bless the tools that they would use to erect the third temple. And the third temple, you know, in prophecy says will be erected in like 3 days. They actually have it prefab. They have a lot of the walls and everything. Like the structure is already there.
IKEA temple.
It just needs to be sort of, yeah, exactly. They need to be stood up, and they need these sanctified tools that are sanctified by the ashes of the red heifer to be used to create this whole temple. So, and yeah, it's to bring about the appearance of their Messiah. The evangelicals believe that it would be the second coming of Christ. And so they actually, I have been to an evangelical church where I was taken aback because this was at the beginning of the whole Israel-Palestine conflict around October 7th. And the feeling overall was the congregation was signing off on these things that were happening because, hey, this leads to the second coming of Christ. And sure, the Israelis, the Jews, they might not like us. They may think that we're wrong, but they're going to see that they're wrong when the Messiah returns instead of appearing for the first time. I believe they call it the Moshiach. So the whole bottom line here is that there is an incredible amount of apparatus that's being put in place by the Israeli government and the religious body of Jews within the Israeli government and within the state of Israel to, yeah, bring about end times prophecy, essentially. And so right now, I mean, it's my understanding that when these rabbis showed up to these farms, because like I said, they had the first farmer bail out. And then all of a sudden, Dan, they within, I think it was the same day, got calls from other farms in the area, and it went from zero to five. All of a sudden, they had five potential red heifers. And
yeah, all the farmers are like, oh shit, let's go. Like, I've got one right here.
Yeah. get that heifer money. So,
get that Antichrist money. Let's go.
That's for the chat. That's for the Israeli money. It was a joke from another podcast. So,
a podcast that I disavow entirely. Go on.
You know which one it is.
I do.
Oh, yeah. They're terrible.
I disavow.
Just disgusting people.
Just awful. Yes.
They are disgusting.
I can't even say their name.
When end times prophecy comes, I hope that it starts with them, honestly. But,
me too.
You know, it's neither here nor there.
I hope Ben Shapiro personally takes them out.
As you know, Ben Shapiro is actually Hitler reincarnated. But this is a different topic. So,
plot thickens.
Yeah. There is... whether or not people, and this is what's really kind of come to a lot of people's attention in, I would say, like the past 3 weeks, maybe 4 weeks. It was like the whole world was kind of sleeping on this. And then once the red heifers reach the age, which supposedly I think there's three or four left, and I know we lost one definitively. I thought we lost two. I don't know if maybe it's being kept from us, but we saw a picture recently where there is three, maybe four of them still viable candidates to be sacrificed. And once the temple is erected, then we're going to get animal sacrifices every day that I believe are probably going to be live streamed. So if this goes that way, they're going to use these sanctified tools to erect the third temple. They're going to do animal sacrifices daily. We're going to be living in weird times because, you know, the government
we
put
gag
orders
on. We can't get a fucking presidential debate, but we're going to get sacrifices on live stream on Facebook. Because, you know, normal shit.
I was gonna say we can't even get the gag laws that are in Purdue factories and such. You can't even get video of what's going on in these factory farms. But we're going to have probably 4K streaming of animal sacrifices in the temple. So
it's going to help make a hell of a banger of a new intro for the show. So thank you.
Oh, dude.
Thank you,
Israel.
Did
I tell you? I don't know if I said it at the top. You have a banger of an intro. It's a great intro.
Thank you.
So, you know, we're changing rapidly the landscape that we exist in, And people have started to take notice in the past, like, 2 to 3 weeks, really. And now as we approach the eclipse, noticing is at an all-time high. So I don't know what's going to happen, man. CERN, the Red Heifer. As I said earlier, the location of the Red Heifer was actually where the X is that the eclipse is forming, which is even more incredible. I mean, we just have uncanny coincidence after uncanny coincidence. And look, even if the Jews are trying to orchestrate end times prophecy, well, how did they orchestrate the finding of that red heifer there?
Right.
You know what I mean? Like, there are certain things about this that, like, a lot of people, one of my buddies, Clint Russell, of Liberty Lockdown, and also an additional terrible show that he does.
Yeah.
Yes.
I'm familiar.
He's a real McCarthyist. He's a terrible human being, yeah. Really. Doesn't matter what label you put on
skinhead.
Him. He's just kind of a snake. Yeah. So he has this thing where he looks at these coincidences and he goes, well, it doesn't mean anything. Nothing's going to happen. And I just go, I don't know. I'm not saying anything is definitively going to happen. I come from a background, as I said, when you're doing this for 17 years now, you're wrong a lot. I'm half retarded and wrong like 75% of the time. And so I temper everything with a bit of caution now. And I'm not going to tell people that something's definitively going to happen.
Right.
But as we've laid out here rather successfully, the scales are being weighed down significantly with coincidences. And at one point, does it stop being a coincidence? And if April 8th rolls around and we have this eclipse and nothing happens that day and the world's not engulfed in flames, I don't think that's what's going to happen. I think this is a sign that we are entering...
If I did, I wouldn't be fucking podcasting right now. Right. I don't think it's going to happen.
People will see this moment come and go and they will be like, look, nothing happened. And it was like, no... If you paid attention, no one was saying something is going to happen. This is almost signifying that we're entering an era of like expedience. Like shit's about to start. If I had to guess what was going to happen, if you forced me to say like, hey, tell me what's going to happen, I would say, well, things are going to speed up and we're going to start seeing a lot more insane shit, which, hey, if in 2019 you said we were going to have a global pandemic and then the world was going to be thrown into chaos and the news cycle was going to become so short,
bullshit.
Dan, I mean, it went from being like, how short is the news cycle? Well, a big event happens every 2 weeks. Dude, a big event happens every other day now.
Yep.
Every other day consistently. And I think that that is going to turn into the times that we look fondly upon. And I think we're going to be inundated with just insane shit show and catastrophe like we've never seen before. And we already are experiencing that. I mean, we've been experiencing that for years. It's just been a slow dial-up of the frequency with which catastrophe happens. And I think somebody's going to put it up if it's jumping from 8 to like 11 right now. That's what I suspect.
What do you think the odds are that on Monday they will wheel out the Nephilim and say that this is the alien takeover, and then we will all bow down and sign up for one world government? What would your grandma think of that?
Would
she be like, hey, what's up, bros? I missed you.
My grandmother, I think, got swept up in New Age shit, and I think she kind of fell for it. She thought she was a clairvoyant. I'm not saying that she wasn't having clairvoyant-esque experiences. I'm just saying she didn't understand the nature of what she was experiencing. I think that there is something that I like to warn people about when they go, I go like, the aliens are just the fallen and the Nephilim and products of the forementioned. And they'll go, okay, so aliens and Nephilim are the same thing. And I go, this is a very important distinction to make. If you have a corporation and a corporation is responsible, let's say a pharmaceutical company, and they do damage beyond repair and they're exposed without a doubt. They have lawsuits out the ass. They've killed countless thousands, hundreds of thousands of people, and they're faced with the decision. They can liquidate and disperse and be no more, or they do what companies typically do. They rebrand.
Right.
They drop the name. They go under a different banner. They come out with a new commercial.
Like MKUltra.
They come out with a new product. Yes. And so instead of having this product that killed you, We change one or two ingredients in it, and luckily now we're able to change the name of it, rebrand it, and push it back out into the public, and yada, 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 and the company gets to go on surviving. This is the same thing that we're seeing with the alien phenomenon, right? We have ancient adversarial entities that hate us, right? They are biblical in nature. They've been here forever, and truthfully, our ancestors had a much better handle on these things. Maybe angels and demons is too reductive. I'm sure there's an entire lexicon of what you could be calling these things. But the point is, they are derivatives of these biblical entities. But instead, they're rebranding. They're coming back to us after, with the aid of Hollywood, with the aid of NASA, and they're coming to us as benign space homies who are superiorly technologically advanced and really just have a concern that we're going to destroy ourselves in mutually assured nuclear destruction or destroy our planet in some sort of, you know, ecosystem collapse because of climate change or what the hell ever. So the point is, they're going to be branded as space homies. They're going to be branded as technologically advanced. When in reality, all you need to do is look at the testimony from alien abductee survivors, and you'll know that this is not a benign entity. These things are very real because of the amount of people that have been experiencing them. And if they're all hallucinations, why do they fit a set of patterns? And dude, they fit a set of patterns. There is a definitive set of patterns that these experiencers can sort of check off a list of, you know, from one to another, we all have these similar experiences. And you can kind of cross-reference them back to ancient people in the Bible having the same exact experiences. They just called them something different. So we like to look at our ancestors like they were retards. But I think they had a much better grasp. You know, people often say that we live like gods in the sense of, like, even a homeless guy has a little black box that he can, you know, have access to all the information in the world, and he can shit in a toilet where he doesn't have to look at it. Yep. Whereas even a king used to have to shit off a tower and have it roll off into the grass somewhere.
Roll down onto the peasants. So, yeah,
exactly. So in that way, we do live like kings, but our knowledge of, like, the spiritual realm and God is just so limited. We're so limited that people a long time ago, they were probably a lot more intelligent than us in that regard. So I just want to say to people, don't fall for the rebranding. Don't get, you know, Exxon Mobil'd. What did they become? They became BP. They destroyed the Gulf of Mexico. And then remember, South Park was like, "We're sorry." They did their whole "We're sorry" campaign, and they came back as BP. And now we don't give a shit.
They sell good coffee, so it's fine. You know, who cares?
It's not bad. Yeah. It's not bad. I like
or Bill
the colors
Gates.
Too.
Bill
like,
Gates
like
is
it.
A master rebrander too. There's a lot of good examples. But now, for newcomers who are wondering why I'm not pushing back much on these crazy ideas, go back a ways and just find out that I mostly agree with them. But Lucas R says, fake super chat. They're literally trying to play God at CERN. Peak Nephilim shit. Yes, agreed. And he also says, yes. Regardless of what you believe, if the Jays tear down the, how do you pronounce that?
Al-Aqsa.
Al-Aqsa Mosque and build the third temple. Hold on. Muzzies, his word, are going to wreck shit worldwide. Yes, and that's another thing that we're getting up to. It, like, with all these, like, we've seen Israel and Palestine fight for our entire lives, basically. But with all the, like, the red heifer thing and them threatening to tear down temples and rebuild temples, it does ring a little bit more concerning than some things that we've seen in the past. And I do want to play a couple of the red heifer videos that I got here because they get into some of that type of stuff. If I can get this to switch. I don't remember which is which. We'll just play this one.
In September 2022, five red heifers were flown from the state of Texas into the occupied lands. They paid around $100,000 for each cow. Since last year, one of these cows have been disqualified, but the other four cows continue to be suitable candidates for the sacrifice. To better understand what this ritual is, we must look at what is stated in their scripture regarding it. In the book of Numbers chapter 19, it is stated that,
"And the Lord spoke to Moses and to Aaron, saying, "This is the ordinance of the law which the Lord has commanded, saying, speak to the children of Israel, that they bring you a red heifer without spot, wherein is no blemish, and upon which never came yoke. And you shall give her to..."
Don't trust anybody who says heifer.
"...that he may bring her forth without the camp. And one shall slay her before his face, and Eleazar the priest shall take of her blood with his finger, and sprinkle of her blood
now,
directly..."
Like, in this scripture, no matter whether you're looking at it from Christian or Jewish perspective, like, if you're taking it literally that there needs to be a red heifer killed for the Messiah to return, did Eleazar get this? Like, was he the one that it was presented to? In this scripture that they're reading, it seems like there are some specific things that they're going for, but they left off, like, it will be presented to Eleazar. Is there an Eleazar? There might be. I don't know.
I'm actually not familiar with that. I haven't, I don't know if there's a man by that name who, maybe there's a translation of that name where it's like, you know, you translate it to English and then you look at all the potential translations into other languages where that would, you know, that would mean that word.
Yeah.
Like, for example, like my name means beloved. And so like, if you wanted to get a different version of David, you might go, well, beloved is the English translation. Now let's look for different words in different languages that mean beloved or a synonym of beloved. And you would have access to like a shit ton of names. So who knows if you'd be able to even track that down, but it does beg the question. It's like, are we experiencing real end times prophecy or are we experiencing a fabricated force end times
prophecy?
Are
we reading like poetry? Are we reading poetry or predictions of things that have happened and then being like, well, we need to focus on this one thing and just forget that. I don't know. I'm not like an all or nothing guy, and I've got my thoughts on the Bible or all of the religious texts. I think that they're all translated and they're all potentially fallible. I don't take them literally for the most part.
They've also all been manipulated.
Yep. And politicized and everything else. So it's like, so just going from this perspective of we need to take this absolutely literally in English, which wasn't even remotely a language at the time that this was written. If we're taking it literally, then find me Eleazar and then we'll talk.
"And upon which never came yoke. And you shall give her to Eleazar the priest, that he may bring her forth without the camp. And one shall slay her before his face, and Eleazar the priest shall take of her blood with his finger, and sprinkle of her blood directly before the tabernacle of the congregation 7 times. And one shall burn the heifer in his sight, her skin and her flesh and her blood,
PETA,
with her dung shall he burn. And the priest
specifically
shall
with her dung
and hyssop and scarlet and
important
cast it into the midst."
That's
of the
interesting too.
Of the
you
heifer.
Hear like the way that it's like scarlet and cedar and hyssop, like these are the types of wood specifically that have to be burnt. It makes you wonder, like when you start hearing all of that. And you go, well, why these specific woods? It's like alchemy plays a role in this. It's things that we don't understand. The energetic disperse of a specific type of plant matter or anything.
I mean, well, even throughout
changed.
The Bible, like in the creation, the building of the temple was very specific, the initial temple. And it was like, you need to find pomegranates of like blue or something, like things that don't even exist in nature. Really specifically, oddly specific things. Continue. Sorry.
No, but I just think that it's fascinating. Like even the red heifer, right? Like nobody stops and says, why all red?
Right.
And it's like, well, we're kind of retarded, so we can't answer that question. But maybe there's an alchemist that could have answered that question at some time. Well, what happens when you get the genetic makeup of an animal that's entirely perfect in its pigmentation? Entirely perfect in its pigmentation. Is there a difference between the chemical makeup of an animal that is perfect in its pigmentation versus an animal who maybe has albinism, right? Are they different on some alchemical level that we don't understand anymore? And is that significant to, you know, some sort of spiritual energy that we're not in tune with anymore? I think that there are things that are lost definitively, because I don't think that when it comes to biblical prophecy, which I do hold in very high regard, I've had experiences in my life that have led me to be a follower of Christ. Like I'll never deny and I'll proclaim it out loud to anybody's face. So I think that there is real importance to the Bible. And I don't think that I think we've lost a lot in translation, and I think that people have messed with the book. But I also think that the things that are there, that were there from the beginning, whatever they are, they're very specific. They're very on purpose. Like everything is said, like when they say cedar and scarlet, that's for a reason. And I don't know what that reason is. We've lost that, but that is for a reason. And I think if you look at alchemy, there are people who dedicated their entire lives to understanding nuance of that nature. And we don't have that anymore. We're so far gone from it.
Yes, that's possible. And at the risk of being the heretic in the room, it's like I mostly relate to Christianity currently. And I don't know, just like in the same way that John Hagee insisted that the world was, or he didn't really insist, but he wrote down that he wrote books upon books about the blood moons and how everything's going to end in 2015, or at least heavily alluding to that. Is it possible that way back in the day, like even setting aside all the translational issues, it's possible that way back in the day, somebody was like, God told me this is going to happen and I see it in the stars and I know it's true. And then they wrote it down and it was just something that they wrote down because they felt like God was telling them that, and maybe he wasn't.
Yeah, I mean, that's absolutely, I mean, it would take a fool to say that that's not a possibility. Of course, that's a possibility.
Like
that's
the slaughtering
why
of children and,
saying,
you know, all that stuff.
Right, Jonestown maybe. And shit. I mean, I try not to say anything definitively because I think a healthy thing to keep in mind for everyone, no matter how much you think you have your finger on the pulse, is to never forget that you are in fact a retard. Yes. And by that token, I could never imagine, when I say that I believe in Jesus Christ and that I'll proclaim his name, it's because I've had personal experiences that at least lend itself to me being able to say that confidently. I'm not a person who, like I said, I've been wrong so many times when I was younger that like I really hit the brakes on yeah. I lacked vindication for a long time.
Yeah.
Like I lacked conviction because I was like, shit, man, I keep saying a thing. Turns out that I think I was just like way behind in the timeline because so many of those things have come to pass now. But that lack of conviction, that like temperance, I think actually served me well. And now I do a good job of tempering everything I say with the fact that I am an idiot. And if you're getting your information from me, hopefully I inspire you to go look up a thing or two and you can make up your own mind, but never take what I say or what anybody else says at you know, as gospel, that's for certain. But you know, when it comes to the validity of the Bible or the validity of these prophets over time, yeah, man, I mean, how do we even know that somebody said the thing that they're being accused of saying all those years ago? And if I was some evil megalomaniac, or not even, I don't think there is evil in the world, but I think the people who are truly evil make up a very small elite group of people. But I think mostly what you have are people who think they're doing the right thing and end up doing the wrong thing. But if you have somebody that seeks to control the people, and let's just say they want to do it because they think they know what's good for that people, well, they might take a very influential thing like the Bible or like any of the holy books and manipulate it so that they can use it as proper leverage over an entire group of people. And you know, we've lost a lot in the burning of the Library of Alexandria. We just had the burning of Notre Dame. You know, ancient texts are lost all the time. The Vatican probably has a library that would disturb a lot of people if they ever got their hands on half of the content that's in that library. So it's a hard time to be somebody who wants to follow God and who wants to have a relationship with the truth. Yeah. And in order to do that, you have to constantly be aware that you're a fucking idiot.
Yeah.
And hopefully that guides you.
Honestly, I love that. And that is, I mean, that's severely lacking in the faith community of any kind. It's severely lacking in the political community of any kind, and even the conspiracy community of any kind. Just for me, like, faith came back around when I was like, oh, I don't fucking know. and that's okay. Mm-hmm. I'm trying. I'm being honest and I'm trying. And that's like, and that's why, that's another reason why I say, like, this eclipse thing from a lot of the people, a lot of the preachers that I'm hearing talk about it, why I say they sound like boomers is because they're not approaching it humbly saying, I'm looking at it and it might be this or it might be that. They're saying, God, well, hold on. Let me pull it back up here. God is saying this is their message.
On August 21st, 2017.
The word Salem, according to Bible, is peace. So God is saying, seven
God is
times
saying,
he offered peace.
Right.
The next
time I know
is coming.
So yeah. To say the word Bible in Salem means peace. Okay, cool.
In Bible.
Follow you. So God is saying, okay, well, now I don't know what to make of you, right? To tell me that Salem means peace, I can vibe with that. Let's see. Does the Bible say that? Okay, that's interesting. Very cool. But then when you go, so God is saying, like, damn, bitch, how do you know?
Right.
I don't know.
Not even God told me this. You know, God is saying it because it happened, and it happened to be seven cities in a thing that is natural. Okay.
Well,
so God
I
is saying
say this.
This.
I have at Nephilim Death Squad, we have a private Telegram group, and we have a significant fan base. They're growing rapidly, and we get a lot of this kind of this sentiment that, like, we're helping these people find a relationship with God again. We're like, the church led them astray, and like, that's really meaningful to me. And I'm trying to figure out, why does this resonate with people in a way where, like, the church doesn't? And I don't know. I mean, I think, like, this guy, for example, you keep saying, like, he's got this boomer energy, and, like, man, that model of human being that's supposed to help you maybe facilitate some sort of relationship with your creator instead is putting a bad taste in your mouth and pushing in you in the opposite
he's
direction.
A fucking
and I
conspiracy
think
theorist
it,
like pretending to be yeah. a pastor it, like the bad kind
yes.
too. Like, I know what is and this is what is, but what if it isn't?
Yes. So my whole thing as a conspiracy theorist is to take something and show you, like, hey, I'm not saying this is real. I'm saying this is interesting. I'm hoping that you'll look yep. at this and do one of two things. Follow this line that I'm on and also go, well, this is interesting. Or follow this line that I'm on and go, no, you screwed up here and this isn't right. In which case I'll go, oh, shit. Didn't see that. You're right about that. You know, so I don't want to tell people what the truth is. I don't know what the truth is. My biggest thing in life is to have a relationship with the truth. Like, the truth is the most important thing to me. And the idea that I have my finger on it all the time is outlandish, dude. Of course yeah. I don't. I'm going to be wrong probably because of how strange the world is more often than I am right. And I'm going to admit that. Like, it happens. It doesn't hurt me because the truth isn't me, it's my interpretation of reality. And if my interpretation of reality is off because of some indisputable fact, well, then it just is, dude. But I think that that approach is what is helping people come to God with us, if that makes any sense. It's like me and my co-host, I say, like, we're not leading anything. We're taking a walk in the direction of what we think yep. the truth is, and we're amassing people alongside of us. And yep. as we're walking, we're having a conversation with them.
You want to go on an adventure? You want to find that nugget of truth? Yeah. That's where we're going. You're welcome to watch.
Hell yeah, that's it. We're going on an adventure. It's just a bunch of retards going on an adventure. And my fan base, by the way, is called Dangerous Retards. And they are. They're dangerous retards.
Nice. I love the energy. I love the humility and just exploring, because to me, that's all conspiracy theories were back in the day. It was like national treasure. Even QAnon, when it first started, like, kicked me off of Twitter for going down that road and just exploring it. I'm just like, I don't trust any of them. I'm like, convince me either way. And I want to hear why certain people believe that aliens are here, or the Antichrist is coming, or Donald Trump's the Antichrist. I want to hear why people believe. I want to hear why people think racist thoughts. I want to hear those reasons. And if they're stupid and retarded and they don't flesh out, then okay, I want to hear all of them. I want to hear why man did not land on the moon. He did not. But I also want to hear why some people believe the Earth is flat, and why which it probably is, and other fun topics. But it doesn't matter what I believe. What matters is where we go and where we explore and what thoughts are off limits. Those are the ones that are the most fun to explore, just because we're told that we can't. And speaking of thoughts that are not explorable, is it possible that Monday, with this whole eclipse thing, is not like this big apocalyptic event? What if it's just leading up to the Candace Owens versus Ben Shapiro debate? What if that's the whole thing? Because Ben Shapiro is very adamant that Candace Owens, if she wants to debate, she has to come to his Jew facility and debate him specifically on Monday at 5 p.m. I don't know if that's around the time of this eclipse. I imagine it's not, but do you think there's any links here between Ben Shapiro and Candace Owens, him insisting it be on Monday?
It is a well-known fact that Ben Shapiro is Hitler came back. And he either came back as Ben Shapiro or he came back as Ice Spice. And we're in the middle right now. It's a tug of war match. We don't know which one is real, but
they're fighting it out.
That being said, it's not that they're fighting it out. It's that I'm watching Ice Spice very closely and I'm watching Ben Shapiro very closely. And I'm just looking for the similarities. And right now they're neck and neck. They're tied. It's hard for me to decide which one is the reincarnated spirit of Hitler. But I mean, I don't know if there's anything. Sometimes I look at these world players, right? Here's what I'll say about this. When I was not somebody who had who was becoming a public figure, right? Because I've kind of rapidly found myself as like a mildly known internet character. And when I did, I was immediately called a Freemasonic shill, thus yep. the brick backgrounds, yep. a Fed. Nope. All kinds of things that yes. I used to.
I talked about conspiracies, politics, and religion. When I talked about conspiracies, I was a shill. When I talked about politics, I was a Fed. When I talked about religion, I was whatever, like Antichrist or what have you. Like they're in all of these sects, they're all the fucking same people, just in a different like flavor. Where they're like, if you think any sort of outside of the box, but you're not exactly my flavor in my box, then you can't be trusted. And I get it, because I feel that way about most people too. Sorry,
well,
go ahead.
What I will say is that I don't know, it perfectly lends itself to this point, is that when I wasn't some like mildly known internet character, I would speculate, luckily never out loud, but I would speculate in my own mind, like, are these people paid actors? You know, the world is a stage. And I still believe that, but I believe much more so now that we are not necessarily actors in the sense that we're aware of the role that we're playing, but I still do believe that we're playing a role, yeah. you know? So since those days, I have come to meet in real life and spend time with people who one could have speculated were paid actors, shills, you know, feds, what the hell ever. And yeah. what I've found is that they are not the remarkable superstars that people think they are, that they are just like you and I, just like the audience, although some of you guys are retarded a little bit more so than others, so maybe not everybody, but they are regular people. Candace Owens is more than likely a very regular person. Ben Shapiro, more than likely, is very underwhelming. Yeah. And so
he's proven it.
I don't think, yes, and I don't think that they are orchestrating something, but you know, that's not to say that I'm not schizophrenic enough to go into some version of reality where I go, will the energy of this interaction lend itself to some other body of energy that's happening right now? Because it's still very clear to me that things are unfolding in a sort of a biblical prophetic way. And so is there some body of energy that this all lends itself to? Is there a reason that these actors are unknowingly playing out something? That, you know, there is strings being pulled behind the street. You know, it's my contention that if you look at all of these elites, right, we say the world is run by the Illuminati. That's your entry level conspiracy theory. The world is not run by the Illuminati. The world is spiritual in nature. Spiritual warfare is a real thing. And there is a dark aspect to it. And when you see these dark actors on the world stage, their strings are being pulled by these people. So when you say, like, is Donald Trump the Antichrist? I spoke to Donnie Darkin, who yeah. is a well-researched sort of biblical theologian. The guy does his homework. He's a great dude. I don't agree with him on everything, but I have excellent conversations with him. And I come away from it going, like, I don't know. I think Donald Trump is one of these people who, if you have a chessboard, some pieces are more valuable than others, but do the pieces themselves act inherently? Are they aware that they're being shifted and the right. and the moves that they're making? No. So I don't
or
think
do they
that
act against
I think
it?
Donald Trump
do they
can,
ever act against orders? I don't know.
Right. So I think that people can be playing a part and not know that they're playing a part. So when it comes to this whole thing with Ben Shapiro and Candace Owens, you know, if I was Candace, I wouldn't do it on the Daily Wire, I'll tell you that much, because yeah. outside of the spiritual warfare shit, why would you go back to a platform and
they
then
just
make
kick
that
you off
dude
because
money?
they didn't approve of your talk points on their platform, and then they're like, oh, you want to do a debate, come back on our platform. Like,
on their free speech platform. Like, come on, man. And so, yeah, I think they're just looking at that from how do we exploit this opportunity to bring more eyes to the Daily Wire. And when Candace Owens declines that offer, she's accused of being a coward by some distasteful players. But I don't think she's a coward. I think she's actually very intelligent. She said something recently that put me off a little bit when it came to this Christ consciousness thing. She used that terminology that's a little too new agey for my taste. I see the new age movement as kind of this false narrative that can be very dangerous. But then again, does that mean that Candace Owens is leading people down a path of new age deception? No, she just used a terminology that she didn't understand that it was loaded.
Right.
And so
she's done that a lot. It seems like she's used a lot of anti-Semitic terminology that she didn't know, like hag. Also, sorry,
I wasn't even aware that was an anti-Semitic thing.
It's not, but it is when it's convenient. So, yeah.
Really? Did they accuse her? They said that terminology? Because
Rabbi Barclay, when he was on her show, was like, you called my daughter, or you called Rabbi Shmuley's daughter a hag. Do you not, Candace, do you not know that? Do you not know the history? Yeah, it's really bad. But
I'll tell you what, when I look at people that claim victimhood all the time, I immediately label you as a bad faith actor.
Yep.
You know, if we're all actors unknowingly, you're
doesn't
a
matter
bad
what,
faith
what actor. Your flavor, your brand, your color, doesn't matter. Don't be a bitch. That's all. Now, I want to say to wrap this up, and I've got two more things, but to wrap this up, what are your thoughts on the eclipse? Do you think, like we've talked about a lot of the different sides of this thing, do you think that there is cause for concern, or do you think it's more like centuries longest blood, like this is an article from 2018, centuries longest blood moon stokes doomsday fears. Is this another one of those? Because it feels like another one of those to some degree, but there's other degrees like the red heifers and things that that weren't, all these coincidences weren't necessarily there at the time. Was it that they weren't there, or that we weren't paying attention because we were just like kids, basically?
Well, there is this notion in the Bible that during the end times, there will be signs in the stars. And now if I wanted to bend something and mold something to fit my narrative, I could go, well, yeah, these past few years where you and I both agree that it seems like every other day there's some astrological event that's going to be the first one in a long time, and it's of some sort of special significance, and maybe even is seasoned with this doomsday flavoring, I could take that and I could say, yeah, signs in the stars, dude, we're in the end times. That being said, I don't know that it really matters. I don't know what's going to happen, but from where I sit after 17 years of looking at conspiracy theories, and the great Sam Tripoli will say that conspiracy theories are a doorway to spirituality, and I agree with that wholeheartedly. I think that you just have to be careful what school of thought you're funneled into. Where I sit right now, it is biblical, and we are experiencing end times prophecy. Have I been wrong a shit ton before? I am retarded and have been wrong a shit ton before. And is it very likely that I'll be wrong again? Yes, but that does not stop me from saying that where I think we're going and where I think we're standing as things are right now is inherently biblical, and we are in the end times. Whether or not we're in the short season or whatever, you know, people who are a lot smarter than me when it comes to biblical theology will tell you a lot of different things in that regard. But I'm one of those people, when you have a body of coincidences, much like the ones we've laid out in this show, when that body gets so large, you can either choose to ignore it or dismiss it, or you can humor it. I think the only difference is between people who humor it and those who ignore it is fear is a driving mechanism that has you ignore it. That mechanism is broken in me. And I honestly look at it and I go, if this is biblical, that's great news.
I wouldn't say I ignore it, obviously, but there's a part of me that that is like, we'll see. And I can't really stop it either way. Maybe like you said earlier on, like the more interesting things get, the better generally, but there's going to come a time where there's going to, you know, COVID point 85, like the next thing. I don't want that. Like
disease X.
Yeah. Like this stuff might happen. Would you say that you think that it could happen? Do you hope that it doesn't? Because personally, same as like predicting COVID, it's like, it seems like this is coming. I really hope I'm wrong. It seems like there's possibility that the end times are coming, Revelation is coming. I hope that I'm wrong, but that might just be my I don't understand what's next mentality.
Yeah, I mean, it's hard to talk from a point of I hope that it's wrong because it would require me to ignore all of the coincidences. But the way that my mind works, it's like I'm a career welder. I'm a husband and a father. And no matter what happens, I plan to put one foot in front of the other as if the world intends on spinning on.
Yeah.
Let's put it this way. Things are looking really good for me. We have a lot of really cool opportunities on the horizon. Nephilim Death Squad is crushing. We're going to do cool things. Do I hope we can continue to do those cool things until I'm old one day and maybe can even retire? Yeah, that would be awesome. But if something happened in the near future or any time between now and my impending doom as an old man that suggested like, oh shit, the end times are on, I would be relieved in a weird way. I mean, I would be afraid, not as afraid as you might think, but like afraid for whatever pain I might have to endure because of it. But knowing that it was inherently biblical and that these end times were, you know, part of God's plan, I would find an incredible amount of reassurance in that, because I do believe that a relationship with God is the most important thing. And I don't tell people like that's what you have to do. I'm just saying that's the conclusion that I came to. As somebody who was not raised religious, by the way, had no one forcing me to go to church, never had any bad experiences with religion, and took 30 years to come to it on my own without anyone guiding me to it, nobody nudging me towards it. I came to this position through 30 years of coincidences. 30 years of coincidences that I looked at and went, you know what? That is not a coincidence anymore. And so, like I said, I don't push anybody towards it. I only ever tell people things that I think are interesting. And it's been working out so far. So if we found out that it was biblical and it was the end times, I'd be relieved. But if it never came, I'd be pumped, because there's plenty of bizarre shit in the world for me to continue showing people and asking them if they think it's interesting too. And if I could do that for the rest of my life, which is genuinely my passion, then I would.
Yeah, absolutely. I've got a lot to live for.
Oh, I just lost you for a second.
Hi. Hey, I was muted. There you go. If it's going to end, I can't do anything about it, but I've got a lot to live for, and I would love to stick around and, you know, live out life as planned. I think there's a little bit of hubris in all of society that believes in end times, thinking that it's going to be during their time, because for thousands and thousands of years, people have been saying the same thing. Like, even if you go back to the scripture that is referenced in all of this, everybody was saying, any day now, it's going to happen. He's coming soon, it's going to happen. All right, well, maybe. But just know that 50 years before we were born, people were saying, any day now, it's going to happen. And you know, because of this sign, that sign, that sign. And here we are with some more signs. I don't know. Maybe. It'll be exciting either way. But I want to end on one final thing. But before we do that, I want to get your plugs. Tell people where they can find you, anything you got going on, and then we will wrap it up.
Awesome. So you guys can find me on Twitter at David L. Corbo, all one word. That's C-O-R-B-O. I spend most of my time on Twitter. You can find me on YouTube, Rumble, Apple Podcasts, Spotify, anywhere else you're going to find your podcasts, at Nephilim Death Squad, where my co-host and I, Top Lobster, and I, we talk about pretty much exactly what this episode was about. Yeah, also a terrible person. Don't watch the other shows that he's associated with unless you want to be made more retarded, which is really not the goal. So you can find us at Nephilim Death Squad. And if you are in Florida, we are starting a series of shows at the Joke Joint in Summerfield, Florida. We're going to be doing live episodes of Nephilim Death Squad. I think they might be weekly or bi-weekly, and I think they're going to be Fridays. So keep an eye out for that announcement. And if you want to come and hang and support us, we'll be doing that live show there at the Joke Joint. And other than that, one more thing. This October is going to be the first official Brohemian Grove, and we'll be at the Joke Joint again in Summerfield, Florida.
Assuming we make it that far, obviously.
Assuming, yes. Yeah. If there's no apocalypse in between now and then, which I don't think there is, I think we're just going to be, it's like the kickoff to like a football game. So somewhere around halftime, we'll be doing Bohemian Grove in Summerfield, Florida. Sam Tripley will be there. Juan of the One-on-One Podcast, Thomas, Paranoid American. I think Clint of Liberty Lockdown, Josie, the Redheaded Libertarian. There's going to be a lot of people there. And it might even be a two-day event. So keep an eye on Nephilim Death Squad for us to announce the pre-sale of those tickets. It's going to be a blast. Other than that, thank you for having me, brother.
Absolutely, man. It's been a pleasure. And again, I will have you on sometime to dig more into, I don't know, your story, your grandma's story, and all sorts of fun things. But it seems like we have a lot of things in common. I would love to pick your brain. Now, going back to the CERN thing, my final thought, first off, follow me at Dan@tsidpod.com is the email address, or at tsidpod on Twitter, who cares, or wherever the system's downs are sold. But the CERN thing, I don't know, I don't remember what it was. We're a couple rabbit trails deep now, but something that you said earlier made me think, like, it doesn't matter if you are like a spiritual person, doesn't matter if you believe in the end times or you believe in any of the stuff that we're talking about here. Look at the CERN thing. Look at, the spirit cooking with Marina Abramovic and Hillary Clinton, her ties, all that stuff. Like, it doesn't matter what you believe. Is it not at least a little concerning that they clearly believe something? Do you think that it's the thing that you believe, even a little bit? Do you think that it's a good thing? I don't know. Just go on an adventure and let's explore and be retarded together and be, you know, kicked up. Fired from our jobs and kicked out of public society for just asking questions. And that's what we're doing here. But Raven, thank you so much for being here, man. We'll do it again soon. This we're going to wrap up on this. I think I'm going to make this a new segment. How old are you? 33, you said?
33. Illuminati remember, confirmed.
Do you remember Blue's Clues?
Of course, yeah.
Okay. Did you watch it as a kid?
Yeah. Back when Steve was the host. I know things have gone south for him since then, but yeah, I remember.
Well, Steve's back. Steve is back, and this video came out a couple weeks ago. We talked about it on this show. I want to wrap up on Steve. He's going to ask you a question, and together we're just going to vent everything that we feel, all of our emotions. Let's vent over each other and just answer Steve honestly, and then we'll get out of here and go enjoy the apocalypse.
Hey, I'm checking in. Tell me.
Well, Steve, seems like the world's coming to an end. There's an eclipse coming. The media is really trying to make us concerned about this. I'm not sure why they are, but it's alarming to me. Join me, Raven.
There's the aspect of the Jews and the way that Kanye West has kind of been persecuted.
Join me
it
less,
seems
Raven.
Like Kanye's been right.
We're still on YouTube, Raven. with this eclipse, are all the emergencies just because there's a bunch of tourists coming in? Is that all it is, Steve? Yes? Did you say yes? I don't know. Maybe.
I worry about the cow. The cow thing is seemingly really terrifying.
I worry about the cow for the cow's
okay
sake.
Also the fact that they're going to
kill
us on TV.
Don't cut us off, Steve.
You look great.
Fuck you, Steve. You look great.
Wow. I don't know. That was kind of nice.
Yeah. It was soothing.
I think we do look great.
We do.
I think he looks a little rough.
I mean, it seems like he should have a little bit more to say on everything we just presented to him, especially some of your input there. But you look great. You look great, Raven.
You look great, dude.
I guess we're good. We'll see you on the other side.
It's going to be all right.
Yeah. And to all of you, thank you for tuning in. Thank you for being here. Thank you for hanging out. And question everything, stand comfortable. We will see you on the other side. If not, Godspeed.
Welcome to the system. Everyone's a victim. Doesn't matter if you're black or white, it hates you all. Here is how the system. Violence is a symptom. Fighting for what's right, but somehow everyone is wrong.